Good morning. Welcome to our Sunday morning service here at Hurricane Baptist Church. Another week's gone and we're moving on. This pandemic can be getting worse in our area, so you don't know what's going to happen with everything that's going on. But just getting a message for this morning, I'm going to look at what's on your mind is the question that came up. And I'm going to be over Romans chapter 8. We'll probably be looking at verses 1 to 11. We won't cover all of that. But that kind of gives us an idea of where we're going to be in. We'll see what's going to happen. What's on your mind? We live in this day and age with the pandemic and the riots and the protests and the politics and everything going on. So everybody's trying to get into your mind, trying to feed you what they want you to know and get you to react in the way they want you to react. And we see a lot of controversy right now about church services and the government's involvement in telling the church what it can and can't do. So we see this mind games that people are playing. And so with the mind is a powerful thing. And when we get to thinking about things, you know, it can wander. Did you ever be sitting praying and you're praying and all of a sudden your mind takes off someplace else and you're thinking about it and you wonder, why did that happen? And I know as a preacher, sometimes we look out in the congregation and it seems like somebody's mind is kind of wandering as they listen to the preacher. But the idea is that our mind and what it has to do with us, with our life and our walk as a Christian. Over in Philippians 4:8, it says, finally, brethren, he says, I want you to whatsoever things are honest and whatsoever things are true and whatsoever things are just and whatsoever things are pure and whatsoever things are lovely and whatsoever things of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on those things. He says, think on the positive things. And, you know, positive thinking is good to a point. There's something to be said for that, but as long as you don't go overboard with it. So the idea, we want to think positive. And over in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 5, he says this. He says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So we see the idea that we need to control our mind. We need to cast down those vain imaginations, cast down and get control so that we're thinking on the right things. And so as we look at this, we're going to see about that, the influence of the mind. And as we're going to look at this portion of Scripture, the value of being a Christian or being not being a Christian, how that works and how we think about that. Proverbs 23, verse 7, excuse me, says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So when what we think about, okay, what we put into our minds and what we focus on, and that's what this is all about, this portion of Scripture. Romans chapter 8 is kind of considered, you know, the gem of the book of Romans. It's one of the kind of the gem, in fact, of the New Testament. It stands out. There's so much in it, and that's why we look at 11 verses, and there's really no way we're going to cover all 11 verses in this session. So I'm just going to read through a little bit, and then we're going to focus on a certain part of it. So let's look at Romans chapter 8. I'm going to read verses 1 through 11. It says, there is therefore now no complete cessation now, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Verse number 8, he says, So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be or since that Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Jesus from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. So we see the idea that we're indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God, and we know that. So I'm going to focus on, in this session today, we're going to look at the verses 5 through 8. We might not get through all those four verses. But the idea is we're going to see what the mind that we're talking about here, the mind of the flesh, is the mind you're born with. That's what we're inherited. We're born with a mind that's separated from God. Okay, we put aside the idea of the age of innocence and all that. Our mind, when we are born, we are enemies of God. We're separated from God. We are dead in our trespasses and sins. So we see the idea that this is the one we inherited. So if we look at verse number 5, and we'll look at the first part of that verse. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. I'm going to change that just a little bit to give a different reading. It says, for they that are carnal do mind the things of the flesh. That the carnal mind focuses on worldly urges and desires, that fleshly mind, that carnal mind. The carnal mind doesn't know God. The carnal mind doesn't understand the things of God. And so the carnal mind is reaching out for those things that feeds the flesh, that makes you feel good. And we're going to look here in a moment, we're going to see that it's not always a bad thing. You know, it's kind of like when we have things in our life that we raise up as idols. It's not necessarily that they're bad things in and of themselves. It's how we allow them to influence our life. And that's also the way we look at the mind. It's how the things that we think on, how they influence us and where they lead us and where they don't lead us. And so that's what God is. He, of course, he's interested in our heart. And so we hear the gospel with our mind, and that then, of course, we put that down to our heart and we get saved if we repent and put our faith in Christ. But the idea is here, he says, that carnal mind focuses on those worldly urges and desires. And there's three areas of life now I'm going to look at here that the carnal mind can focus on. And first of all, it looks at the material and physical aspects of life. That's the idea of looking at lusting for sex, power, influence, position, possessions, all those kinds of, all the things that I can accumulate, all the things that I can make be that impresses people, makes me feel good about myself, and all those kind of things. That's the carnal mind. And we normally think, when you hear as a Christian, we talk about a carnal mind, we think about a mind that is looking at a lust of the flesh, that's looking at those things out there that feed the flesh, that really don't care a lot about other things going on in life, but just taking care of themselves and meeting those needs. That carnal mind, that fleshly mind, and there's a war that goes on continually between that flesh and that spirit that indwells us. There's this fight that goes on. In fact, if we look back over at the 7th chapter of Romans there, we see Paul talking about the things that I know I should do, that I don't do, and the things I know I shouldn't do, that's what I do, oh wretched man that I am, that constant fight. And so as a Christian, I want you to know that when you get born again, when you put your faith and trust in Christ, we're now indwelled by the Spirit, but that doesn't remove all the fleshly influence. That doesn't remove all the fleshly desires. And so there's that struggle that goes on. We have the Spirit and the Word of God, and we know that what we should do and how we should act, but that mind sometimes plays tricks on us, and it'll make excuses. So we go a little bit further, and it says here that not only can we focus on material and physical things, but also moral, upright, cultured life. Sometimes people that are unsaved, they're carnal in their nature. It's not that they're out there a bad person. They could be a moral, upright person, hardworking, honest. They want to do things. They want to have a good, comfortable life. They want to live a good, clean life. They want society to be good and be beneficial and everybody enjoy it. And so they'll live that kind of life, that's a moral, upright life and education and all those kind of things. But what happens is they're focused on the wrong thing. As in the first case, they focus on material things. In this case here, they're not focused so much on material, but they're focused on that lifestyle, a kind of life. And so the focus then isn't toward God. And those things, again, a good moral life is good and great as a Christian. And it's good for a non-Christian, but it doesn't bless God. It doesn't please get you, draw you closer to God. That kind of person sometimes feels like their good works. If I can just be good enough, I can just live good enough, I'll be faithful to my wife, I'll be a good father, a good husband, I'm going to work hard, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, now, then I'll please God. Surely, somebody of my stature, when I stand before God after I die, and he sees all how good I was, surely he'll accept me. Surely I won't be rejected then. And there's that idea is more prevalent than you would think. Just living a good life. I can remember one time when somebody asked me, and I shared it before, when my mother mentioned to me, and I said, well, Mom, hey, I'm as good as those other guys are. You know, I believe in God, and I do this, and I do that. I didn't realize then how wrong that was. But now we see the idea that that's where my mindset was. That's what I thought about. So then the next thing I looked at was the religious life. We have people that live that religious life. They focus on a religious life, the good works. They go to church. They do the things. They work in the church. And maybe they teach a Sunday school class. Maybe they do Awanas or Bible school or things like that. They're working in the church. And they've made a profession of faith, probably. If they're doing that much in the church, they've made a profession of faith. So the idea is then they're trying to do the good things. They're trying to be right. They take communion. They get baptized. In the Pharisees and that, they would go to the synagogues. They would fast and pray. That's how the Pharisees were. They did all the things that they needed to do according to the law. They fasted and they prayed and they did all these things. And he said, surely, look at us. Look at that old publican over there that time. You remember the story about the tax collector. Look at him, what he is, and look at me. Look how religious I am. Look at me, God. Surely I'm pleasing you by doing all these things. And my mind is telling me that's good. I hear the false teachers tell me that's good. The false teachers, they'll get it and they'll play with your mind and they'll give you ideas about what's true and what's not true. But what they're doing, they're leading you down that bad path. Or if you just believe long enough, if you have enough faith, it's possible. Well, we pray according to God's will, so I'm not going to go into all that faith praying and everything else, but we do need faith. I'm not denying that. But just because I believe it and I want it to be so doesn't mean it's going to happen. So the religious person that with that carnal mind, he's doing all the work, looking good, in the church, all those things, and people can look at that person and say, wow, what a dedicated church worker. Look at her or look at him. How they're surely going to heaven when they die. They must be saved. But see, they've never established that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Their mind is working away from that. They're not being drawn. They're not allowing themselves to be drawn to that. So the idea is then that this carnal mind, when we talk about it, most of the time, again, we think about somebody that's perverted, sex mind, you know, just all about sex and all these kind of things. But we see the carnal mind doesn't necessarily have that. But the problem with the carnal mind is it's focused not on God, but on self. It's focused on everything else. The flesh is focused on the flesh, that carnal, that fleshly idea. So we go a little bit farther now. In chapter 8, verse 5b, the last half of that, he says, first part, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Those things that we're after, the things of the Spirit, the spiritual mind is a natural mind that has been renewed by the Holy Ghost. If we had the natural mind, before you and I got saved, if you're listening, you're a Christian, before you and I got saved, we had the carnal mind. That's what we were born with, that carnal mind, that fleshly mind. But when we get born again, then we have a renewed mind by the Holy Spirit. Over in Romans chapter 12, in verse 2, it says this, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed, how? By the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. He says you need to be, don't conform to the world, to the flesh, to the carnal mind, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Get your mind focused on other things. Now, we're not focused on the world, we're focused on the things of God. Question, are you focused on the things of God? When it comes to your life and your likes and dislikes and what you're going to do, are you focused on what God would have you to do as a Christian? See, we can get caught up in carnality. Now, we don't have the fleshly mind, but we can get caught up. We can get our mind pushing us away, and we get looking at things back from the old days and so forth, and we can be drawn back to that. But that indwelling Holy Spirit wants us to focus on the things of God day by day, moment by moment. Always, it's not that we're just walking around quoting scripture and praying that all the time, but we're always mindful of who we are and the need we have to please God with our life. We want the world to see a difference. And I want to tell you what, in this day and time, it is very important that the world see a difference between the believers and the non-believers. We need to be that testimony. We need to work on the spiritual fruit, the love, the joy, the peace, the faith, the goodness, the gentleness, the meekness, the temperance, the long-suffering, those kind of things. People need to see that in us, that fruit of the Spirit coming out as the Holy Spirit works in you and I. They need to see that. They don't need to see it with the carnal mind. That's why when we talk about alcohol and things like that, what does that do? That identifies me more with the world than it does the church. and we don't get into all the things about alcohol, the pluses and minuses, but that those kind of things, when you take a drink as a Christian and other people see you, they identify you more with the world than they do the church. And I know that I can get all kind of arguments and all kind of disagreement about that, but I want to tell you what, if there was no alcohol, there'd be a lot more people walking around this earth today alive and not crippled that have died and been injured because of alcohol. So be that as it may, I'm going to be focusing now on having that spiritual fruit in my life. I'm going to be focused on the work that I've been called to do. Over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, he says this, "Now then we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ that be ye reconciled to God." We're ambassadors for Christ. What does an ambassador do? He reflects the will of the nation that sent him. He reflects their values, their ideas, what they're wanting to accomplish. That's what the ambassador does. And we are ambassadors of Christ, so people should see us as that Christ-like figure, that in the image of Christ, that we're trying to do the things that would please Jesus, that he would be doing if he were on earth. Reaching out in love and keeping focused on our call. We need to be focused on the idea that we're to be more like Christ. We're to be conformed to the image of Christ. In the same chapter, chapter 8 of Romans, we go down to verse 29, and he says this, he says, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be what? To be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn amongst the many brethren." So what I see there, I see that I am to be working and focusing my mind on how I can be more Christ-like. How people can see more Jesus in me, if you would. So those that one verse, and then we go ahead and get down to verse number 6. It says here that for to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. See the difference? The fate of those two mindsets. The carnal mind leads me to death, a spiritual death. And when I have the idea of the mind of Christ, now the spiritual mind leads to life and peace. The carnal mind stays away from God. The carnal mind stays focused away from God. Remember, as we looked at verse 5 there, everything for the carnal mind was about self, about fulfilling the lust of the flesh, whether that be through sex or drugs or what, or power or positions and all those things, or the idea that I'm going to be a good person, I'm going to be a moral, upright person, I'm going to be live good and impress people with how good I live. Or the idea that I'm going to be a religious person, I'm going to go to church, I'm going to look very religious. See, that's the carnal mind. But the carnal mind never turns to God. The carnal mind is never focused on what it takes to please God. So many times I hear people say, well, you know, God's really going to get them for that. Well, they're talking about an unsaved person that said something or did something. That's the carnal person. Understanding the world, and you know, as Christians, and sometimes we get caught up in our own little circle at the church, especially in a small community, and we're so used to being around Christians that we forget sometimes what the world is like out there. And now and then you get a glimpse of some of the stuff that's going on the news around the world, up in Minneapolis and out in Oregon and up in Philadelphia and these kind of places in New York. We see see that the carnal man. We see how they act. And we talk about the Christian and then the world. We should see a conflict. And that's why it's so important that Christians maintain their testimony at this time. Stay focused on the things of God, not the things of the world. The world wants to distract you. The world wants you to pay attention and focus on the things of injustice and the things like social justice and this kind of justice and equality in the workplace. And all these things have a place. But I'm going to tell you, as a Christian, we have a call. We have a call, and our call is to do the work of him that died on the cross for us. Remember when he died on the cross and he had those disciples and they become apostles and they went out into the world and they changed the world for Christ? And they all died. But the fruit of their labors goes on. And we are the fruit of the fruit down the road there. And so we have that responsibility not to get caught up with all these other things. Yeah, to be a responsible citizen and understand those things. But I want to tell you what, it's more right now more important that we stand firm in the Word of God, that we not be distracted, that we not be drawn away with all the things that's going on right now. This is scary times. This is very scary times. And if you're counting on your 401k or you're counting on something in the world to get you through these times, you're liable to be badly disappointed. Because things are changing so fast and we don't know what tomorrow's going to bring when it comes time for the workplace, the financial markets, just the safety. Look over in Beirut, Lebanon, where they had a big explosion. All kind of people got killed over there. We see all these storms happening, things happening in people's lives. So if the carnal man keeps the same carnal mind through this lifetime, then he will have that permanent separation from God. He's already walking through this world separated from God. His mind is away from God, and he's separated from the mind of God, and he will ever be separated from the mind of God if he dies like that. And for you and I that are born again, we're born and we have that new nature now. We now have the spiritual mind, and so then we'll never be separated from God. We're on the same page with God. We have that relationship and that fellowship with God. And so as we look at this, he says here that there's the contrast, the carnal-minded is death, but the spiritual-minded is life and peace. So then we get to the point of you have to make a decision. What would you like to have? Well, would you rather have an eternity separated from God, dying with a carnal mind, rejecting God? The carnal people hear the gospel. It's not that they never hear it. Some accept it and some reject it. But the idea is not that they never hear it, but they reject it. They don't want it because they don't fit into their lifestyle. They don't fit into their plans. I've heard people say, I know I need to become a Christian. I understand that. I know I'm a sinner, and I know I need to get saved. But not now. I have this going on in my life, or I have this going on in my life, and I don't want to stop doing this, or I want the opportunity to do that. And so later on, before I die, I'll become a Christian. Well, you could write a book on what's wrong with that statement. First of all, the Bible tells me over in John 6:44, it says, I can't come to God unless he draw me. And so what makes that person think that they'll be drawn by God at that time? What makes that person think that they'll have their right mind at that time? What makes that person think they'll even have time to make a profession or a confession of faith? To have a heart change. I just seen here just the other day, I believe it was up in New York City, a man and his daughter were walking across a crosswalk. She made it. He didn't. He got shot and killed before they got across there. They both left the curb alive. Only one made it to the other side. Do you think that as he was walking there, and I have no idea his spiritual, I know nothing about it except what I heard on the news, but you think that he was thinking as he's walked across that crosswalk, well, if I die now, I better go ahead and make my profession of faith and trust Christ as my Savior. I've been wanting to do that. And do you think he thought about that? No, he didn't. My wife and I, we've traveled a lot through the years, and we've seen lots of accidents. Thankfully, I've witnessed the accident happening just a few times. I've seen many accidents. I've seen, I hear just the other day, we seen a motorcycle that looked like it was a pile of spaghetti. It was all wrapped up and tore up. We see vehicles all the time that where they're tore apart. Right over here on 19, we saw one here a couple years ago where the vehicle was just tore apart and they had a body laying out there. Do you think those people had time to think about, well, it's time now, I'm going to die, I need to get saved? Well, they didn't. See, the Bible tells us today is the day of salvation. You can't put it off. You don't want to put it off. When the God speaks to you, you need to put your faith and trust in Christ. You repent. You turn from your sin. You turn and put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't. You're fooling yourself. You're listening to the devil. Not now. I'll do it later. So many, many times, later don't come. says right there in verse 6, for to be carnally minded, to be fleshly minded, is eternal death. It's death that's spiritual death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Going down, we'll get down to verse 7. Because the carnal mind, look at this now, the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's hostile against God. It's an enemy of God. The carnal mind is an enemy of God. You realize that? That people out there today are walking around, and they might be good moral people, they might be religious people, but they're enemies of God. They're hostile toward God in the fact that they can't do anything to please Him. They can't do anything unless they turn, unless they turn from their sin, put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and be born again. They can't please God. There's nothing they can do. And he says right here, this carnal mind, this fleshly mind, is hostile against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. They're not under the law. I don't know how many times people come up to me and they'll say, well, you need to talk to that person, especially sometimes with spouses. You need to talk to that person. Well, they're not saved. I can talk to them, but I can't take the Bible and hold them accountable to the Bible. They're not saved. They're not a child of God. As a child of God, we can be held accountable. We are accountable to be obedient to the Word of God. And when we violate the Word of God, when we're disobedient, then we need someone to come up to us and tell us that we need to change. Those that still have the carnal mind, they're not subject to the law, neither can they be. But the idea is that they're enemies, they're hostile toward God. And we're going to stop there. We'll finish these up next week. We'll finish up this rest of this chapter. But I just want you to stop and think about it. What is your focus in your life as you walk through this pathway of life? What is your focus? Many times I'm asked, how can I know I'm saved? What can I look at to prove I'm saved? Well, we look at 1 John, and we know it was written that you may know you have eternal life. But I want to tell you, one of the things that you can look at is, what is your focus in life? Are you focused on the things of God? Are you focused on trying to please God according to the Scripture? Are you focused on trying to please man or trying to please self? What is your focus? That'll tell you real quickly where you're at. If your focus is all on the world and the things of the world, then you need to sit down and pray and ask God to forgive you. And if you're born again, then to cleanse you and to put you where you need to be. If you're not, then you need to put your faith and trust in Christ. So we're going to pray right now. And if you're listening to this today, I want you just to stop and think, am I a Christian or not a Christian? If you're not a Christian, don't put it off. If you feel the urge right now to put your faith and trust in Christ, do it. Believe God. God said, if you put your faith and trust in the shed blood of His Son as payment for your sin, you have eternal life. You turn to God, put your faith and trust in Christ. And if you're a Christian today, you need to look at your life and say, am I leading the kind of life that reflects the power of God in me in the presence of the Holy Spirit and the influence of His Word? Am I focused on the things of God that I want to exalt Him, that I want to glorify Him, that I want the world to see how great it is to be a Christian? Those are the questions only you can answer. I can't answer them for you. But I want to tell you what, He already knows. You can't fool God. If you're not a Christian, you can tell the world you're a Christian. You can be baptized 100 times. Won't mean a thing if you're not a truly Christian. God knows that. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank You for this day and for this time. And we just pray that You be with each one of us as we walk this pathway of life, Lord. We want to be found faithful to You. We want people to see a difference in us. We want to see a good difference, a person that's loving and caring and contributing to society to make it better. And not in the worldly sense, but in a godly sense. So work in our hearts and lives as Your children. Lead us. Help us to be a blessing to You and a blessing to others. And for those that don't know Christ, Lord, we pray. Those that we even list on our prayer list that we pray for daily. We just pray that You would touch them, that You would open our hearts and open our eyes, and You would send someone. Send someone to share the gospel with them. And we pray, Father, that the heart that You touch to go will be faithful to do that. And we pray that we would be faithful to do when You call us to go. We thank You and praise You again for loving us. We thank You for what You're going to do, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.